Started here after the break. So I think this is my favorite presentation because it's cash flow. So cash flow is so important as a business owner. Your success thrives on cash flow. Cash is king. It's the blood flow of the business. Everything that you put in your business plan, especially for the startup, it leads into this cash flow. Your business plan is what supports the fact that you go to the bank and say, hey, we are going to make $300,000 this year. This is how we're going to do it. These are the costs that we're going to have. And I'm really happy to have Bruce Thurston back, who many of you remembered from week two. And as you guys have already met him, and you guys know I like to let my speakers speak for themselves, give a warm welcome to Bruce, who's going to help us learn a little bit about cash flow.
Okay, cash flow is king, and you've heard that. But you're going to witness it as you start to build your individual companies now, okay? And I'm going to tell you that there's two big problems in business, cash and people, okay? If I didn't have any people in organizations, just had machines, sales order systems, life would be great, right? I spent an hour, 5 o'clock to 6 o'clock with a client, and their issues were an employee is working for them that doesn't conform to the values they have in their business. So how much longer are you going to let the pain go on? Bad hire on their part. They didn't do the work up front. Nothing wrong with the person, just doesn't fit within the organization that they're in. Cash, I was in a meeting from 8:30 till 10 o'clock, and I looked at these people's financials, and it's all about cash. So we talked about alternatives on how to manage their cash more effectively. So today, we're going to use Morley's presentation. I've stepped in for him. So you're going to see some PowerPoints that are Morley's, but I'll talk to them. But I want to show you something rather unique that's out there right now. There's a guy, top 40, under 40, Obed Maurice. He has something called Maxim Management. And he's in TechConnect, and I spend a day a week at TechConnect helping people from a business perspective, and they have the technology. I give them the business sense of things. But he has a new idea that's out there, and it's taking off quite well. And he's got a 1 minute, 36 second video that was produced locally by some phenomenal guys at Output Media in TechConnect that talk about a new way of looking at business. And let's just see what he's got to say. Hopefully the sound.
Over the past 25 years, a very big change has happened. The world went online. We went mobile. Our money moved to the cloud. And this is a good thing for your business. We are Maxim Management, the accounting firm of the future. We've handpicked the best cloud-based accounting tools to streamline business finance in ways that weren't previously possible. We make technology work for our clients so they can take care of all their business needs anytime, anywhere, from almost any device. And our clients always have the peace of mind knowing that everything is reviewed by a qualified chartered accountant. Let's say you're a plumber, like Jim here. Jim used to be constantly overwhelmed by outdated paper processes and boxes overflowing with receipts. Now, Jim has the power to quote, invoice, pay bills, collect receivables, complete payroll, track expenses, and schedule jobs, all from the palm of his hand. Jim feels confident knowing that his professional accountant works year-round on his business and is always just a quick call away. Because of the custom-built solution from Maxim Management, Jim saves hundreds of hours a year and is able to spend more time doing the things he loves. Our monthly fixed pricing means that there are no surprises. You can spend less time worrying about administration and more time growing your business. With Maxim Management, qualified accounting isn't just simple, it feels automatic.
So he's disruptive change in the accounting world.
Yeah.
Okay, he's disruptive change in the accounting world. And what I wanna be able to demonstrate is that there are, and to me it's like a lot of your projects that you're putting out. You know, you're going to have disruptive change. One of my buddies bought a Tesla, and he took me for a ride two Fridays ago when the storm was out there, right? And we were flying down the road. I was not comfortable, but it was self-correcting, right? And we were flying past all these people. I said, I don't want you to crash. You just got this thing. It's got 103,000 kilometers on it. It's a 2013, and I didn't ask him how much he paid for it. but he always wants to know that part. But he says, Bruce, we measure it by battery life. It's an 8-year battery, and I bought it used. It has 3.5 years used up on it. I've got the rest. I said, what do you do for servicing? He says, well, that's the point. I change tires. Winter tires to summer tires. And when they wear out, I buy tires. The only thing I could identify that was common to my vehicle was windshield wipers. Okay? The heat was instantaneous. I didn't have to wait for an engine to get my body warmed up, and it was darn cold, right? And it slick. The power, we would call it the torque. He likes to drive fast. Boom, right? So I got something off my bucket list, and then he said, Bruce, I'll let you drive it when the weather's nicer. And we put the 21-inch tires on, okay? And I'm going, oh, okay, that's my reincarnation list. So I'm going, this is really, really good stuff, you know? So where can I go now?
I hit escape.
Escape, awesome.
And then you can go to the other tab there.
Yeah, super. So get rid of that. And I'm looking for...
Up in the very top left of that Chrome, Bruce.
Top.
If you open back up that internet. You can very top left.
Oh yeah. See. Super. Yeah. Awesome. I used to teach in here. Sort of forgot things, eh? So cash flow, it's not boring. It's no different than what's in your wallet. I have Mint from Intuit on my phone, right? And it tells me how sad my spending power is personally, right? So every week it will tell me on a Friday how I was doing. I'm always glad it's the end of the week because I've spent way too much compared to budget. So there's nothing different with your business than with what you're doing personally, and I'm a lousy example of it. Just as I think I've got it right, I have a daughter, and she practices what I call the open wallet approach. Dad, e-transfer, right? And all, and so it leaves here, just bills in here, and it goes into hers. And it's so fast, it bothers me. I'm used to checks that took a couple days in the mail, and sometimes you tear the bottom and delay them a little longer, because they had to be manually input, right? Okay, so it's not that way anymore. And folks think that, so page down. So folks think that I'm a little old-fashioned that way, but man alive. I've got to get all my clients on e-transfers now. But the city of Lethbridge doesn't want to do that, right? They're going to take their 30 days before they pay you because they know the value of cash. So let's talk about a little bit today. Objectives, introduce financial controls, and you are yourselves, and how well you discipline yourselves is important. So every receipt that you get, write something on it because you'll forget what it is in the future. Keep both receipts, the transaction receipt and the detailed receipt. CRA will not reject you then. Do not go out and buy $700 worth of wine, as one of my clients did, and try to write it off as a business expense. Are you serious? You know, come on. You know, and so lots of people will play that game. It's when you get caught that it's not fun. So be objective, be frugal, spend your money wisely, especially when you're starting up, and monitor where you're spending it. So we'll talk cash flow and managing cash flow here. Build your business exactly the way you want it to be. So Morley would tell you, you've probably done SWOT analysis, strengths, weaknesses, and you've got a vision of 5 years, 10 years. In this day and age, 10 years is a long time, right? Where our phones are just celebrating 10 years right now. A lot's happened. And they're coming out with their 10th anniversary one, and I'm always behind, of course. So it's going to be interesting. I'd love to see what they come out with. So I agree with a vision, because if you begin with an end in mind, you have a higher chance of probability than let's just go out and do something. So Joe Plummer says, I'm tired of working for the man. I'm going to go out and start doing my own thing without a game plan. You're in the right program here to think about the game plan that you've got. So, your risk from the unknown high risk to a calculated risk. So putting a cash flow together will tell you if it's feasible as to the idea that you've got. Okay, it'll tell you if it's feasible. I have some dear friends, AirTech HVAC. They started 13 years ago, their own company, and they put a business plan together that had best case, most likely case, worst case. And they were guys that had worked at Charlton Hill, and they did their jobs very, very well, but they decided to go out on their own. And they took that to Alberta Treasury Branch, and ATB was perplexed. They had never seen anybody in small business come with three options. But these guys weren't fooling around. They didn't want to lose money. They were making a serious decision of leaving their employer and going out on their own. And they didn't want to make a mess of things because they had house insurance, house mortgage, car payments, all that kind of stuff. They took it to ATB. ATB was blown away and gave them the money because they had really thought out what they were doing. They had spent the time, and it came from their mouth. They had the language. So calculated. So they did the legwork to figure out how they could possibly put it together, do the research, and be accurate. I'm going to show you one of the projects that I worked on called the Blood Tribe Grocery Store, now Kanai Market. And I had to determine if there was a need for a grocery store on their blood reserve. They've built one now. It opened up in September, but here I am. How am I going to figure out? And I had to take a look at the population base. And if you've ever looked at a map of housing on the Blood Tribe, it's all over the place. There's only 163 houses in Standoff. And there's Laverne and the other folks that are together, right? But they're spread out so much. Would they come to Standoff to buy groceries? Or would they go somewhere else? So, you know, I'll show you some of the analysis that I did in that particular as an example as we get going here. So, do the books. So, Simply Accounting QuickBooks, he's got these. I have the eMyth Mastery. I think it's a tough book to read, but Michael Gerber is an easy guy to listen to. So sometimes the books are hard, but the audio and video presentations are really good. So Michael Gerber has made a gazillion dollars by creating these books, and you can go and take a course for, I think it's $30,000, and become an eMyth Master and charge it to people in Southern Alberta. That could be one business that you want to do. I think they charge $2,000 a month for their services, at least it was. And in your business or in their business, they create systems. And so I want you to think of your business as a system with inputs and outputs and a flow. And the logic that you can build in it is really, really important. So City asked me to do a contract on December 23rd, and I said I can start January 1st. So that's their holiday. So we chatted January 2nd. I put some options together, and they said we like it. They got approvals, stuff like that. It's an X number of dollars in the process for approval on procurement. And then I had to have my insurance in place. I had to have a contract in place. The risk department had to review the insurance. And then it went to solicitor's department and through a whole bunch of things. Started talking about December 23rd, got my contract signed January 23rd. So if I was working and needed money, that system's not going to work for you. And then the deal is, I send them an invoice and they pay 30 days later. So if I needed money right away, I'm not going to get it working for the government. Right? So think of who your customers are. Are you going to be getting cash right away? It's beautiful if you can do that and get a system like that. Subscription-based is where it's all going. I wish I had subscription-based services right now. I don't. So it comes and goes in waves, right? So he's got this one here, and you'll be provided a cash flow worksheet like this, and I've got one if we want to play with it a little bit. But what we're really looking for, and this is important when you put your proposals together, when I judged in the past, I would look at this very, very carefully. And I would say, okay, cash in this particular business, they sell furniture and giftware. And when are they selling their product? So you can see their numbers as to when their biggest sales are, and they're in May, June, July, August, is their big time for selling and moving their product when it comes to the furniture. And you can see the giftware is pretty intense in July and August there. So things are in cycles. And it's just not straight line. So when somebody gives me a business plan that's got straight line, you're kidding me, right? I had roofing company, and here's January and here's December, and those who have been in executive service with me before, I apologize. Here's the work situation of a roofer. Right? Because it's darn cold in January, and it's darn cold in December, and you're not out there, or if you are, you're wasting time because you're not efficient in the process. Cash flow for roofing. Okay? So think about it. We're starting up with some crews, we're bidding on some jobs, and you'll find in industries we always bid too cheap in this period because we want to get this work. We're afraid we're not going to get any work, so we don't bid properly. So then all of a sudden we'll get some work at too cheap of a dollar. Tradesmen are all the same. Okay? Too cheap of a dollar. And then the real work comes along and we don't have the capacity to do the real work with the real margins in it. Call us stupid. Right? Okay, so you'll start doing some work. You have to order materials. And of course, the suppliers control the marketplace. And you're going to have to pay them 30 days after the stuff comes in. And you're going to order those materials, and you're going to put the material on the job and apply it with your labor and stuff like that. And hopefully you invoice in a very timely fashion, and you'll invoice those guys 30 days. Sorry, you'll invoice them at the end of the month. So let's say March 30th is one of the months. You'll be lucky if you see that money by April 15th. Okay? And that's just for your first job, your first month that you were working on. So what you'll find is you're having to pay your people every 2 weeks. You're paying your supplier every month. You might have sub-trades that you're paying every month as well. And so your cash actually is like this. And you'll find that this cash point leverages when you start slowing down with your work, doing less work, because all of this money starts coming in. And in December, I have the most cash in the coldest months in the roofing industry. Okay? It's an inverse relationship to what is logical and intuitive to most people. Most people think that work takes off and boom, that's my work and my cash goes with it too. But you have people to pay that labor. Okay? One of my tragic situations was when I was in EMBA school, I met with a client who has a big facility in Lethbridge here, and they said, Bruce, we're doing a job in Lethbridge. We met in Nashville internationally to take a look at this job, and we're practicing project management more effectively. And they said, okay. I said, how much is the job? We think it'll be $250,000. I said, great, let's do it. They had not looked at the job in the same amount of detail. I think they enjoyed being in Nashville more than the actual work that was required. What ended up happening is the job cost $1.2 million. Okay? They had corporate approval for this. They did not have corporate approval for this. I was left out hanging for 9 months before I got to see the difference. If I did not have bank financing in place, I would have been down, right? But you have to have an operating line of credit in your business for those unexpected moments, and you need to be on top of it. This is a company that could pay it, but it was the politics. They only had approvals for this, so what did? They generated purchase orders over a period of time and paid them out to me to make up the difference. Everything we did was approved by them, everything. I didn't hose them or anything like that. This was planned. Quite a learning experience. After that, I took project management, got my master's certificate in it, and I then called the shots. I needed that skill in order to manage it. So in this particular section, you've got cash in. When's it gonna be? So you might do the sale, but you might not receive that money. So it's receipt of that money that's so, so, so important. And if you don't manage that, I've got one client who gets money in advance. Let's call it a deposit of 50%. The worst thing they could do is spend that money, but they do, right? And they can never get out of that hole because they don't make enough money on the jobs to ever get them out of that hole. So we say, using Peter to pay Paul, don't get caught up in those scenarios, it'll kill you. And then in this particular scenario, cost of goods, so they bought furniture and giftware, and this is when they're having to pay their suppliers for the different product. And then they've got a gross margin. And I'm a real believer in margin. Know your margins. So if your business is proposing that you're going to sell something for $100 and it costs you $90 and you have a margin of $10 to pay for all the rest of the things in your business, don't do it. If your business is $100 and it costs you 10 bucks and you've got $90 margin, call me up. I'll help you. I'll help you spend. Okay? This is really, really important. So in restaurants, the life expectancy of a restaurant is 8 years, unless you're in the big business. Okay? Take a look at Google. Find out what margins in restaurants are. You'll find that if you cannot sell alcohol, you don't do as well. The alcohol is where the money is made in that world. So if you're a breakfast company like Cora's and you do lunches, that margin's a heck of a lot different than a keg would be that's open at dinner time only. And I'm shocked at the people that go to the keg. Our economy's not doing too bad, eh? Wow. And then I go over to Freshies here. An interesting new place, Freshies. So I'm looking at their food product and I'm adding up the costs. Because I can make it at home versus when I go out there because I'm too lazy and put it together. And I was there tonight before I came here. Clients, crazy. So, and I look, and university students and young people and fit people going in there. Absolutely amazing. And I said to the guy, how's biz? He says, we're 3 times better than we planned. I like that. Okay? But he also has another place in Cochrane, not the same scenario. He said to me, and it's public knowledge because he doesn't know me from Adam, he said to me that the pattern of purchasing in Cochrane is different. It's a bedroom community. And we thought we'd do better at lunchtime than we are. But everybody comes back from work and then they go in and they buy the product there, right? So fascinating, fascinating operation. And so then down below gross margin, the way they got this set up is they take a look at loan or financing or anything like that. And if there's any payments that have to be made, they come out of there and they show the cash balance. So total cash coming into it and then cash out. So on whatever they've got as their financing and on this startup, you can see they got a loan for 29 grand. Other financing, some $100 and some existing cash they must have taken out of their account for $7,800. They put it in a startup, and that's the money they had available. And in January, what they've got as coming in from cash in from the business they're in, the cost they had to pay their suppliers gave them a gross margin, and the total component as to cash out for the month of January. They pay loan, rent, telephone, power, water, all that kind of stuff, and they've got a salary. What I really encourage you to do is make sure you put your wages in there. Don't say, I'll pay myself out of profit. Profit's used for 3 things. Profit's used, so the profit that you get, is used to pay debt, is used to buy things that you need, such as equipment, to expand your business. And the last thing is to pay a dividend. Last thing is to pay a dividend. Only if the numbers work out do you pay a dividend. Okay, so don't even go there for the first little while. Put the money and keep the money in your business and allow that account to grow. Because in the roofing business, if you don't save your money and have it in your bank account, you can't start up the next year. You don't have the cash flow to be able to pull it off. So you've really got to manage your money wisely. Know where it is, be frugal. So telephone, try to be as cheap as you can. Only get the stuff that you need, not the fanciest items. Don't drive the Tesla. You haven't earned the right to, okay? The guy that's got the Tesla, like I said, bought it used. He's been busting his butt for 35 years, and I'm glad to be his friend. but seriously, I don't want one. But I had my experience. Isn't that the way? It's usually that journey to achieve something that's more fulfilling than being stuck with the debt of a Tesla afterwards, right? So, you know, really think about how badly you need it. So this is spread over a 12-month period. So in some businesses, we would do weekly. In other cases, we would do monthly. Don't do quarterly. Don't do annually. It's too far spread apart. Too much happens. And we say activities drive costs. So the activities on the revenue side is what did we sell, and then we see it up here. The activities on what did we spend, we see it up here. So it's what you actually do that determines what the dollar element is in it. So connect yourself to your activities in your business to what the dollar output is in it, and you'll be right on the money in it. So for example here, when I described, I talked about the order taking. I talked about hiring labor. I talked about getting the materials. I talked about applying the materials on the roof. I talked about invoicing. That's all activities you do in your business, and it has a dollar component to it. If I take somebody out for lunch, I'm taking them out for lunch, that's the activity, it's costing me, right? I'm writing John Doe on my receipt, and then the tax department doesn't give me a write-off. I hate that word. There's nothing to write off. It's a darn expense in my business. And would I have taken that guy out for lunch if he was just a friend? Not a chance, especially if he's a lawyer, right? If Stephen was here, I would say that to him because I love him. Okay? But there is nothing better than getting a check from a lawyer, right? Because usually it's the other way around, and they've got a neat profession, very much so. So they have to manage cash flow too. You know, if you're into personal injuries, you'll work on a case for months and years. And then it's solved, and you got a 50-50 chance of winning it. And if you win it, there's a big cash outlet there. So imagine that. So often you'll see lawyers do a lot of real estate transactions, which are cash to keep their company going, and then they'll be in that other avenue, which can really make the windfall if they're good at what they do in litigation. So same with yourselves. What can give you a steady stream of revenue in your business? If you can find a steady stream of revenue, it's good. But I don't want you to fool yourself. There's patterns to everything. There's patterns to how you buy food out there. And when you're buying food, before Christmas is crazy in a grocery store. After Christmas, it's inventory. How can we move this stuff, get this stuff out? Maybe one exception is Costco. Blows me away, right? Blows me away. That's an amazing business, right? So, project, month-to-month, cash flow, and the principles of goal setting. SMART, so he will impose that, so specific, measurable, right? That whole world. And then take a look at where your flow is. When are you actually going to do business? So this was his idea of what months, what volume am I doing? Okay? If you happen to be a Santa Claus, and that's your sole business, you start November 1st and you shut her down 6 o'clock on December 24th. That's your period. So think about further. You're a landscaper. You're going to start in March and you're going to go like heck. And then you heard our ladybug arborist, awfully cold. And this snow hasn't helped her situation in the last little while. She can't get around. It's not as easy to walk through all those snowdrifts trying to cut bushes. And the last thing I'm thinking about is trimming the bushes outside my house right now. You know, so can you build systems that you build a relationship with your customers to be able to have those things done? And the good ones will do that over time, but it takes time. So importance, an integral part of your business plan. So I take a look at everything you've got to say, and I really want to know about your market. I really want to know about your customers, because that'll tell me if you can generate the cash. So it has to be realistic. And then they've got no wages, no suppliers, no cash, no sales. There's a reality check to it. So if you don't have things happening when you expect them to, it's a problem. So build a cash flow, determine your expenses that you're going to have on a monthly basis on that sheet of paper that you've got. Establish the trend. Here's my roofing trend. Yes?
So how do you, if you're starting a business from scratch and you've never worked in that industry before anyways, how do you establish a trend? Like, I get it if you've already worked in the industry and you know it and you're just going out on your own.
Yep.
But when you're starting, how do you establish a trend? Are you just kind of guessing what you think is going to happen?
So for example, the Blood Tribe, I studied everything I could by Googling everything I could on grocery stores. Okay, everything. And I learned that there's trends. And then I talked to the people who provide the food. And in this people, it was Federated Co-op. And they said, this is the typical trend for a store of your size for sales. And then they also told me what dry goods were versus produce versus the meat section, right? So they gave me that indication, but I had checked a lot of it out. Because there's a lot of information out there, because a lot of government organizations have built business plans or systems to help people out in different business areas and different sectors. It's amazing what you can find. So it's not just yourself, it's you making contact with people. Okay? Does that make sense?
Kind of, I just don't know who I would even try to talk to.
So let's talk afterwards and
yeah,
I might be able to help
have
you
out.
Every Wednesday I'm at Tech Connect. I sit there so lonely. They pay me to sit there, and all you have to do is email me at this address and say you were in this class, because sometimes people are connecting me and I don't know how creepy they are, so I don't respond. So just say you were in this class, okay? And I'll help you out. So, and that is the piece. That's really, really important. That's a piece. So for example, if you're a plumber and you're looking at new home market, this is a really rotten time to become a plumber for the first time in new home market. I read in the paper the permits have dropped from 50 to 20 for the month of January. This is the first time I've seen the Lethbridge market drop on building permits. They usually have 850 a year building houses in this region. And this was the first sign. Whereas in Calgary and Edmonton, well, we say Brooks is in receivership. Medicine Hat's not doing too good. This is a little bubble, right? So think of your Joe Plummer, tired of working for the man, starting out on his own. What's your chance of being successful in that industry? Not too good right now. Not too good. You got to have a real good relationship with somebody, and they think you're a superstar to take you on in the marketplace. So sometimes you're fooling yourself as to what you're capable of at this point in time. Monty Saylor was a welder. He's Southland Trailers. They're the largest trailer manufacturer, I think, in Canada now. Okay? What he did is he went and worked for the man. And he understood the processes in two operations. And then he went out and started, and he undercut them on costs. His costs weren't as high. And he built his empire. But what his trick was, he got to know that industry. So usually people starting a business can be successful if they've got a skill set, right? This gentleman has a skill set in a certain area. I've gotten a chance to know him, and he's learning the business side of things, coming to this and ExecuServe and everything else, right? And that's cool, because he's blending what he's got as that skilled talent with the business knowledge, and he should be a success. Right? Should be. Okay? So, market research is a fancy word. You've been in a number of things, but I'll tell you, I live by Google. I really do. And anybody can, would you agree?
Can I say something?
Sure.
For me, I found the same thing. It was really, really, really hard for me to try to find people that do what I do. I started trying to search, if I was a customer trying to find me, what questions would I type into Google?
Beautiful.
If I was trying to hire myself, how would I go about doing it? Which made for a really, really long week.
I did that. But it didn't win an event. So any of my questions for establishing your terms.
Really?
Really.
Interesting. So let's talk. Okay. Be glad to. I'm lonely at Tech Connect. I'll even buy you a beverage. Because they've given me the money to do that. It's a beautiful place. So capacity to deliver. I'm going to pick on Tim a little bit here. But he had not much 6 months ago. He now has lots of things to work on that can generate him real cash. And he has talked to a lot of people that have helped him determine what should my rate be out there? How should I charge things? So he's used the network of people out there to inform himself. I could sit in my basement office and I could try to do a business plan. It's the wrong thing. Go out and ask people what they're looking for. Get a feel for what they're looking for, because you could be fooling yourself. You may find that you want to manufacture Saskatoon pies in southern Alberta because they're somewhat available. Saskatoons are not as easy to harvest here as closer to Calgary. A Saskatoon harvester has discovered that after buying equipment from Europe and the whole shooting match, right? And the Hutterites don't mind picking it for him, right? But it's better up north, get a better crop out of it. Now, he can export that because a lot of other people like Saskatoons, right? All those kinds of things. There's guys manufacturing, raising eel on farms here and shipping it to Europe. Our horse facility, I was in Japan eating raw meat and they advised me that I was eating something that was local. Horse tongue. I prefer things cooked. But you see, they're shipping to markets that demand it. So it's thinking out beyond just southern Alberta in this process. And with technology, I was bragging about Output Media shortly. They're doing a lot of work for people that are in Vancouver, but they're in Tech Connect, and the speed of transmission is 850 megabytes per second there, which is, John, is that outstanding speed? Outstanding speed, okay? And they can do all kinds of wonderful things as a post-production operation. And Output was the one that put Maxim's little video together, too, to try to hit the point off to people, okay? So the opportunity's out there. I can't stress it enough. And I often feel that the market research is often the piece that's most perplexing, but when a few gems hit you, it'll take off. Watch, okay? So we'll help you out. So we talked about in sales revenues, projections, capacity to deliver in year one, and market research. So often year one, you're trying to get yourself organized, so you cannot do as well as you think you can. That's what I talked about. Best case, most likely, worst case scenarios. What can you really manage? What can you really handle? And I'm serious. I'd rather try to handle too much than too little, unless I had 8 children to take care of. Then it's a different story. So what's your personal circumstances? Are you working somewhere else now that will restrict you from being able to put your full-time commitment into it? Will it be a part-time type operation till you seed it and get it going a little bit more? Nothing wrong with that. And then out, what are your variable expenses and what are fixed expenses? Accounting terms, variable expenses vary depending on the volume of work that you're doing. So for example, the furniture people there, if they buy furniture, then it's a variable expense, right? And if they sell it, you can see that expense grows if they sell more and more because they're paying their suppliers. When it comes to fixed expenses, it's your rent. You've signed a 5-year lease with a personal guarantee. That's a joke, don't ever do that, okay? Don't sign a 5-year lease when you're starting something off. Test it, do not sign personal guarantees. And then if you have signed some kind of commitment, make sure zoning restrictions allow you to be flexible and sublet it to someone else. And I'm serious about that because I've run into 2 people in this town that have not done that. And man, does it kill cash quickly when you're having to pay somebody and you can't afford to, okay? So, and that's where Joe Lawyer helps you out to decipher some of the documents that landlords like you to sign. And you initial the bottoms of those saying you understand it. And most people don't. And it's a very sobering reality when you go in front of a judge, Judge Judy, she says you initialed the corners. That means you understand it. Ignorance doesn't help in a court of law, right? So you want to make sure that. So fixed expenses, and there's some examples here. So rent, utilities, telephone, internet, wages, benefits. And often when I'm at, let's say, ExecuServe, they'll say, I've got a business without any expenses. Call me, I'll be glad to be part of it. But everybody's got expenses. My computer expenses for my consulting are 22% of my sales. I need John to help me reduce those costs. Man, that printing. My wife says, why can't I have some jewelry? I said, you do. It's called printer ink. Right? It's printer ink. It's unreal how you get, how that game sucks you right in. And I deal with several types of people. I deal with millennials that it's all electronic, and I deal with senior citizens that they want it in triplicate. handwritten. So that's my market. It drives me wild because I have to adjust to it all. So these are legit components. They have drawings there where you're taking money out of your small business. But that's where I believe you should have wages and discipline yourself to drawing $2,000 a month, maybe $3,000 if you've got a pretty decent plan. But you really want to manage within your means. And that's where you can trip yourself up. Okay. The other component is inventory. If you need to buy inventory to start up, just buy a little. And what I encourage people to do is test the market before you get into big production to see if they're interested in that product that you have. But just buy a little. Don't tie all your cash up into inventory. Okay? I've seen a situation where people brought pallets of stuff and they had no money to pay and were paying high interest rates. I think I mentioned it when I saw you last time. So this kind of thing. Vehicles. I have a personal vehicle. I charge 55 cents a kilometer up to a certain level, and then I drop it down as per CRA standards. But I use my calendar to tell me where I drove, and then I've used Google Map to tell me the kilometers. And last year I drove, it was somewhere around 21,000 kilometers for business, right? I go up quite a bit to Calgary, I go into the interior, BC, things of that nature. So it adds up. So I do that component of it. I told you I worked for City of Lethbridge. They wanted my certificate of insurance on my automobile. This is risk management at its finest. I said, I don't, my company doesn't own my vehicle. So my insurance guy had to send them a letter telling them what my coverage was, which is $5 million coverage in case I do something to a person who wants deep pockets and have that kind of coverage. $500,000, $1 million, those kinds of things don't cut it in that world. You've got to have some decent insurance or they reject you, of course. So establish the trends as to when your work's going to be, and that's a classic example of when you're going to actually be doing your work and what's your capacity to deliver. Can you really be at 100%? Or will it be 75 or 50? So I said best case, most likely, worst case scenario. So if you've got equipment that breaks down, so I'll give you a classic example. When I was at Green Prairie International, they press hay. And first day I was working there, they were buying a multi-million dollar press. And I said to them, why don't you buy two smaller presses? And they say, why, Bruce? I said, because you'll never be down 100%. You'll be down 50%, and you can keep the product moving. Well, you know about farmers and the ag boys. It's the biggest machine that wins, right? Got to have those big presses, okay? So there I was watching the video, and the engineers told them how quickly this machine could function. But it was engineering statistics under perfect conditions, not with the human element, right? Not with the hay being of a different quality, requiring different things. Beautiful guys, phenomenal entrepreneurs, tough work in that business, absolutely amazing. But they export. And do you think they're making money, the exporters in Canada right now? Huge money. It's when that they can buy in Canadian and sell in US dollars on the market that generates huge money. So that's why you often hear on the news, you may be disappointed it costs you more money to go down to the States, but I'm happy that our people are able to produce stuff and get it into the United States at lower prices right now. It's all about that game. And if they're happy, farmers happy, it builds this economy. So very, very important. Okay, so go to market, is the market big enough? And that's the other thing, is often people are fooling themselves. And I told you, this is a big Raymond, not a little Calgary. So they talk about the market size being 117,000 people, if I read it in the paper the other day. Coaldale is almost as big as Tabor, that fascinated me. Thought, interesting, right? Fort McLeod has only grown by 100 people in 100 years. They're 3,200 now, they were 3,100. 100 years ago, okay? So how do you find that out? Google, find it out. I was helping some dentists in another region and they said, is there a market for dentists? And so I went to the Chinook census data, Chinook Health Services census data for that region. And they told me all about the demographics, how many babies were born there, how many teens are there, what the ages, how many seniors were there, the whole shooting match. And I matched it up to what the buying patterns with dentists are. And then I went and looked at the Canadian Dental Association. They said in Alberta, one dentist for 1,800 people. So I looked at that population. There was no dentist, and there's 6,000 people. I said, there's capacity to be able to serve the market. But this place is very, very close to BC. BC dental rates are cheaper than Alberta's. So I said, take the BC dental guide to determine what your prices should be. Right? So you won't compete with Sparwood and Fernie and Cranbrook. You'll be able to say, my rates are the same as the BC guide. And you'll be able to satisfy that. But have two rates. For those who have dental plans that are Alberta-based, you may charge them something different. For a while, anyways. Right? Because if you're reading the news, they're going to come down and bring in a dental guideline. So I Googled that, and I learned a lot. And I can tell you what Mutual, the health service folks, and Blue Cross's rates are for a cap and a crown and all this kind of crap. They pay me to do this stuff. That's why I Google it, right? So that's my world. So you can find it. Give yourself a chance. So this benchmarking tool that is available, I clicked on it, and then I went and took a look at HVAC people. And it told me what the typical expenses are, and it told me for the quartiles, so the really good companies versus the really bad companies. And it showed me all that kind of stuff. And you just plug in what you're looking for, and a number of things came up. So dentistry would have worked in that area. Food services would have worked in that area. It's a very, very common site to go to. And I tried it last night just to see if it still works as well as it did in the past. I do pay $3,200 for another service every year that I can then dump a client's numbers into and project 5 years out and give them that information. Very few accountants give you 5-year trends of your financials. I would encourage you to always ask for that once you get going here. Because when you look at things just this year and last year, and then you compare it over 5 years, it's a whole different story. You can really see things. So I'm always interested in what those trends are. Morley's not here today, but this is his connection, and he'll walk you through the cash flow statement in detail. Tell him I told him, told you that you could use him. But seriously, I saw his presentation last year, and he did offer many, many times, and he's employed. You pay him to sit in an office, right? So you might as well keep him productive. And he's a good guy. He will come and tell you he was in business and he messed up. It's called cash flow. He really blew it. He didn't understand enough about business before he went in, and he learned the hard way. And I'll tell you, it's a sobering experience to run out of cash. And when people are weeping and can't make payments, it's a disgusting, sad, sad, sad scene. In some cases, they haven't seen that the market wasn't big enough. In some cases, they spent too much time buying fancy equipment, not the basics. So lawn care guys and stuff are famous for that. And they got these loans. And even though interest rate is low, you still got to make principal payments on things. And in my world, when I was your age, some of your ages, it was 18-22% interest. You got to make a lot of money. And what I worry about right now is when I see the bottom line in a lot of businesses at low interest rates, they'll never be able to survive when the interest rates go up. They will not. It's the same as people who have big houses that are beyond their abilities. When those interest rates start creeping up, hallelujah, there's a problem. And that's why the feds came down with that means test in October and blew a few people away.
And just with that last slide too, if you guys need a copy of a cash flow format, you can email either Morley or myself and ask for it, and we'll send you one back.
So here's extending terms of credit, and the thing you want to do is cash is king. So if you operate a cash business, it's beautiful. But if you allow people to pay on credit, it's very dangerous. Okay, so I was a sewer cleaner. I worked for Roto-Rooter for a year. I was making $6.50 an hour. As a roofer, I was making $1.65. I thought I was rich. Okay. But he would extend credit. And I found that there was a theme about it. People really need you when they're plugged. That's when you want to ask for the money. Okay? Now they improved, because I had backup sewer on an August long weekend. And so I called them in. They said, it's going to be double time. It's going to cost you. So for 2 hours, it was $400.
Okay.
And so I was going to cut my check. They said, we don't take checks. The bookkeeper doesn't like it. And they unzip a pouch, and they've got a wireless machine. And they said, we just need your debit card. Thank you very much. Right? Oh, that just smacked. That stung, right? But hats off to them. Now think about the sewer cleaning business. The technology hasn't changed for 75 years. It's still a steel snake with a blade on it. But the cash collection is right on the money, right? You know, absolutely beautiful. Okay?
People kept ripping checks.
Yes. Seriously, that thought had crossed my, I'll go get my check. Oh no, we don't take checks, we take debit. I'm going, wow, these guys are really good. Smarter than, right? So it can be very dangerous to extend credit. I was so stupid. I manufactured aluminum and stainless steel horse trailers, custom built, and I would sell them to Americans. And the Americans say, I need it by such and such a date. And it usually was a Friday. And they'd come in with their big truck and dually wheels and the big 10-gallon hat, you know? And I say, I gotta pick that trailer up and get through the border before it closes. And we'd be so proud of the work we had done. And they'd say, man, you Canadians, you know how to build a horse trailer. And then he'd get in his truck, drive away, and we sent him a bill, and he said, man, are you guys stupid? Try to track down and collect on a trailer in the United States that's on wheels. Right? Like, seriously, don't do that kind of stuff, okay? So you'll overextend yourself. Construction company took on a project at the mall here. And Toronto guys who deal with all these real estate deals are very shrewd gentlemen. And they take on some Hicks construction guys from Lethbridge, Alberta. And what they'll do is they say, hey, we're gonna give you 10% down. And we're gonna pay you during the whole contract. And at the end of the contract, we'll pay you the 10% holdback that we've got. And I watch these poor guys. They put a bid together, but they hadn't done their homework. They needed some very fancy glass. And this was in 2008 when everything was busy. But this fancy glass was for the front of the store. And only two glass manufacturers in North America make the stuff. And there was a 6-month lead time on the order. And they had signed a contract with the guys from Toronto in January to have it open by April 30th. Okay. They got it open in September. Lawsuits, the whole bit, right? They lost their shirt because they hadn't done the detail that's required to run the business. Instead, they were a bunch of cowboys. Okay? Like, I meet contractors that do $100,000 worth of work, and they seem to think that just adding a zero is nothing. It's sort of like a cowboy way of doing things. That's $1 million. That's 10 times more than 100,000. That is a lot of work and effort that goes into a job. Okay? And then I'll meet guys who have built a few houses and now they're trying to compete in the industrial world. Houses are made of wood. Our fine folks in the industrial are concrete and steel. And the two don't mix. And industrial guys don't know housing building codes. Housing guys do not know industrial building codes. You're crazy to try to go there. Okay. Like, you better really know your stuff if you're going to move into that world. And you better have help. So calculate when you'll actually receive the payment and accounts receivable management. And in my consulting business, I send bills on a regular basis, and I've only not been paid once. $3,100. It's funny how you remember those things. They're out of business. And I left after a few hours because I could read that these guys we're going to be out of business. I was blown away that it took them several more years. But what they did is they found investors and they sucked those investors in. And the investors did not do their due diligence, but boy, could these guys sell a story, okay? Wonderful guys, well-meaning, but they didn't understand the stuff that you're learning in these classes. And they've taken people down. And it's pretty significant. I can't say much more without revealing who those kind of people are. So, how will you manage your cash? Never let your cash balance go to zero. So when I build my cash flow, I always say I want to maintain a balance of money. Let's say 5,000. Bigger businesses, 30,000. Always keep that in the bank because it's a timing of when you're paying your suppliers. So you may set it up that you're going to be having to pay your supplier on the 10th of each month. And yet your cash flow might show that you think it would be at the end of each month. So you really want to watch the terms. And bankers will encourage you to collect as fast as you can and to pay as slow as you can legally. That's the style, okay? Legally, okay? And I encourage early payment discounts because a 1%, 2% discount, when you annualize it, is very significant monies. So take advantage of those discounts, and that's why you need cash in your account. So discounts, pay when you have to, watch prepaid expenses. They can really suck you in. Okay? So, you know, think about TELUS, Rogers, Bell, all those guys, you're prepaying. They have your cash before you're using the services. What a beautiful business to be in. Can you do that? Can your business allow you a subscription system that you pay at the beginning? My wife pays to Good Life Fitness and never goes. Like, how much percentage of their clientele is like that? Great intentions. Stronger intentions in January than in July. Right? Okay? So that pattern, and those guys are so smart because they take it out every 2 weeks.
So it's a small amount and you don't care if it's missing.
Ah, beautiful, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. And all those small amounts really add up. Don't get sucked in.
And if they do it every second week, but say that you're paying a monthly fee, because they're doing it every second week, they actually get a free month out of you throughout the year.
Yes.
Because they're not doing it on the 1st and the 15th, they're doing it bi-weekly.
Yep.
I also contribute to a gym that I don't go to, and I just figured that out.
Well, hats off to you for discovering it before you're my age. Good stuff.
I feel like I'm going to go have a conversation with the gym owners because I know them. We're kind of friends. I'm a big guy. I think you owe me some money.
Well, good luck on that.
Good luck, yeah.
But I think he understands cash flow really good, you know? And let's look at that. Good Life was really popular. There used to be women's only, a locally owned gym that I thought was absolutely fantastic, run by local people. Good Life came in. Now there's Orange Theory.
Orange Theory.
And I bet if I was to look at Good Life on the south side now, that a lot of people from the west side have switched.
And they're opening up another gym in the old London Drug thing, and they're offering $4.99 every 2 weeks.
It's a different brand, but the same company, right? And so I'm going to say, is Good Life going to be open? Yeah. Okay. Will it still keep its model, or does it have to reinvent itself? One of my biggest, dumbest moves was I had the largest roofing company in Lethbridge, and I should have opened up another one to compete with myself. Okay, to take the marketplace.
Yeah,
right. I wanted to, but my partner didn't. And I seriously. So what happened is I lost three really good guys. Went out on their own, TWR, and they were really good guys. Worked like. You gotta love hardworking roofers. They're still doing it today, and they're in their late 50s. I love those guys. Right, you know the dedication. And I could have made them very rich and ourselves very rich by not being so narrow-minded and being more open-minded on focus. So I was just talking to a great guy at Tech Connect today, and he was saying, oh, I don't know if I want to do this deal. So I suggested to him on this deal that he try it with somebody. So try and test the waters. Don't do a deal without figuring out if the culture and relationship works with an individual that you're working with. Take their spouse out for dinner. Talk to them. Build a relationship to see if there's a fit. Otherwise, don't waste your time. And the other guy will appreciate that too. You really want to know if you fit with each other. And that's what builds relationships. So even though we're in such a transactional-based environment right now, so many of the things I see coming back to, when was the last time you had a relationship with people? It's people I had a meeting with today. I said to them this morning, when was the last time you talked to your key customers? They looked at each other. I said, are you serious? They've been in business 6 years. And I said, come on, guys. You know, when was the last time you asked them what they needed in their business? Now, one of the things we talk about in what's moving ahead in business planning and stuff like that, what are your customers' pains? So you're solving their pains. You can be the best contractor out there, but if you're not connecting with the customer, it doesn't matter. And then more importantly, what are the gains that they'll get out of it? So if you look at Maxim's video, what's the pains? Well, you saw the plumber with the water and the paper and all this kind of stuff. They emphasize that. And what was the gains? Time to enjoy your life and not be bogged down at midnight thinking about doing those stupid books, right? Thought very, very interesting. He plays on it. And Obed, he can run his business. He knows all of his clients' financials on the mobile phone, and it's a very secure system, more secure than the banks. I hope so. That's what, because they need to be secure. And he was in Phoenix for a month last year working. He's scheduled to be in Hawaii for a month, and he will work with his clients using technology. So he'll Skype them, right? Now, how many accountants do that for you? And it's a different relationship model that's now being built. And so it's going to change. It's disruptive change, just like Tesla. Tesla, of course, is a computer on wheels, and our traditional vehicles are engine on wheels. And it's revolutionary. It's very cool. So watch prepaid so you're not sucked into them. Purchase equipment from profits or plan. So what I said is buy equipment out of the money that you've got available. And only buy what you need to begin with. Okay? Don't get whole hog and say, I need this, need this, need this. Don't do a Walmart. Don't go through with a shopping cart. Only get what you need.
Speaking of disrupting the system, did you hear that Warren Buffett pulled all the shares out of Walmart today?
Did he?
Because you said Walmart and then I thought about disrupting.
Yeah. I find it very interesting. When I taught here, we would often watch some of Warren Buffett's videos. But if you take a look, I'm shocked at how few view that guy. 400 or 500 views on some of his videos. Take a look at See's Candies. Ooh. See's Candies, okay? And See's Candies originated in San Francisco. He bought that company and he talks about how much stinking money they make. And that's very seasonal because he made a lot of money yesterday, Valentine's Day, okay? Absolutely amazing, but his cycle. Bernard Callebaut, the chocolate place, Wowzer, that little tiny chocolate. There's margin in that business, okay? Absolutely amazing. Love the Boschmans, hats off to them, but look at the story of the entrepreneur and how he lost his business. How sad is that? And then you may have seen him on Dragon's Den asking for $500,000 from the dragons, but he was unwilling to allow them to have 51% interest. Right? I would have had the 51% interest. I would have taken it from those guys because I'm the chocolatier and they're better at business than I am. I would have been glad to have had that. And can you imagine the current Bernard Callebaut chain, what the chain reaction would have been if he had had that backing and that notoriety from the dragons? Fascinating. But it didn't go that way. How sad is that? And he tried to start up his own operation, and it's really too bad what can happen. So keep accounts receivables timely. So one of the biggest challenges is people don't like to phone and ask for money. You gotta be on top of it. I hate for people to have receivables. Don't do like I did with those Americans. I wrote off $106,000 one year. $106,000. Call me stupid. My wife did. Implications of extending credit, you lose control. So Roto-Rooter has control, you lose control, don't do it. To ensure loans are paid, make sure you pay the community futures people on time, right? Bankers don't care about your business as much as they care about doing what you say you're gonna do. You want to build it in and make sure they're paid. Whether you go out and party at the keg or not, make the payment first, okay? determine how much to borrow. So the cash flow allows you to see your patterns and when you really need your money. So I knew what my operating line of credit was in my roofing operation. I had five different businesses, so this was one of them, and the cash flow of this was different than my furnace business. My furnace business, it's a little bit different, but this was sort of the style. We had January to December, and I call it the thermostat. The thermostat clicks in often in October. That's mind for people. How's my furnace running? And that sucker will run through to here, and then it drops off. Okay? Then when it gets hot in the summertime, okay, that thermostat demands air conditioning. We find that if it's really hot in May, we sell lots of air conditioners. If it isn't, we sell nothing. People say, honey, we're away for 3 weeks in the summertime. Okay, that's the norm. It's usually the first week of July. Why they do that, take kids out that are happening in school. It's insanity at its finest. You're having a rest. And then usually the first 2 weeks of August. How do I know that? I did my market research by talking to the Lethbridge Herald. Right? They will tell you when the slow times are. Buying TV ads in the summertime is not always the most effective. They'll have the best deals for you. But is that who you're trying to reach in the process? Those kinds of things. So May, so think about it. And in October, so we'll sell furnaces in October and November, but they would die in December because they've got other priorities. They would die in January because of bills from December, right? RRSPs, right? Tax, all that kind of stuff. Other things that are more important in life. And I was in a business that sold metal boxes in basements. And people would rather pay obscene amounts of money for granite countertops on particle board, right? than my metal box that kept them warm. Think about how stupid that is. That rock will outlast their lives. But think about how many are going to get crunched up shortly and replaced because it's the in thing to do. And on a lineal foot basis, it kills me. I wish I was in that business. And that's the other thing. Research and find out where the money is. Coffee. I was fascinated by the coffee. You know the farmers get nothing. It's the green beans to the roasted bean stage that the biggest margin is. You buy them for a dollar, back then it was 50, it's more than that now. And you sell these roasted puppies for anywhere from $10 a pound up to $17 a pound out in the marketplace. It's like printer ink. Right?
The great thing with coffee is if the weather's bad in the growing season, your prices for coffee go up.
Yeah, but I really do believe that it's quite adjustable because you have this margin to play with, right? Whereas in some other businesses, the margins are so tight, a small percentage increase will kill you, right? So that's the idea. Okay, so let's see. Many bidges, we sort of talked about that. Cash is king. You have to have cash to operate. We got it. And here's the personal net worth statement. So a good way to figure out what your liquidity is, and often Community Futures will ask, what's your personal net worth? He's got that. You can have that to fill it in, but to see where it is. It's really simple to me. I often show people and say, okay, you may have things, but it's like what we call a balance sheet. Here's your assets that you have in life. Here's the liabilities, what you owe in life, and here's what you own in life. So you buy a house for 300,000 smackers, right? Okay. And you have a mortgage for 250,000. Okay? You put 50,000 down, you own 50,000 of that house. That's all. Now people drive by and say, ooh, they must have lots of money. Nope, they have lots of debt, right? Lots of debt. And I think what's going to be very interesting is as the baby boomers try to sell their overpriced houses, it's not going to be as liquid as they thought it was going to be. Because the younger generation will rather buy new the way they want it than buy an old oak house. And in the 80s, oak was class, Now people are painting over oak, and I think that's so sad. But that's just my own preference, right? So, and what I always say is, in business, buy the assets that make your business work. Don't buy assets that don't add value. So there's where you're frugal. So buy equipment that you need, whether it's computers or whether it's something industrial commercial, buy what you need that will work for you. Don't get extravagant with stuff. When it comes to marketing and advertising and stuff like that, that's an expense that you've got, and make sure you're getting total value. Tim and myself, we were involved with a client who's I can't say much about it, but they are paying an obscene amount of money to people who promote social media. And we showed them the kind of money that normal people would pay. So it's no different than my wife in The Good Life, what normal people would pay if they use the facility versus people who don't use the facility, what they pay.
Okay? Isn't your daughter instructor?
Shh. So
my wife goes there too.
So I've got a daughter who's instructs at nighttime there, and I think she's probably wonderful, although I would never take one of her classes because I could never keep up, I'm sure. But here's her goal. She's going to Hawaii in May for 3 weeks to start the yoga certification process. And she has researched that big time, right? She's got all worked out, a US dollar, all worked out, the whole bit, you know. And she says, I need to strategically do that to enhance my skill sets for the next evolution of what I'm doing in my life at nighttime. And then she has a day job, right? And so what I love about millennials is they have so much potential. And what I'm disappointed is that many organizations don't tap them to their full potential. And so I'm a real believer that there's going to be a huge organizational shift in the future in institutions like this and other government institutions, and hallelujah when that day comes, because I think we'll really see some cool stuff. And so hats off to anyone who's a millennial. I wish I was again. Personal budget. So I started off saying, hey, you got a personal budget? Mint tells me my sad personal budget situation all the time. And think about it. Just keying into Mint, which is free of charge. Intuit runs it, so it's a very, very secure system. It will start to analyze you, and the truth gets told to you every Friday. And it really can be sobering. And then it will tell you what you really should spend, not what you do spend. And then you can set it up to send you warning signals if you want. I'm not that strong yet. So personal budget, and that's the end of their presentations and stuff. Does that make sense to you? Did that help?
Yes.
So are we past time?
A little bit past.
Do you have any questions?